anybody for that matter, needs to just have an over impact on themselves and not let things that they have no control over affect their lives in negative ways.
Yeah, Greg.
They should pull themselves up by their bootstraps, even if the father anally raped them every day.
Yeah, they should.
Get over your damn anal raping issues.
What? Can you tell me what the alternative is?
Trauma. Well, what does getting over it actually entail, anyway? So how does one get over things?
Probably denial. Pretending it didn't happen, just like, it was a nightmare. No.
You know what you do? You just move on with your life. If I fell down the stairs tomorrow, on Friday, if I sat in my room and just felt bad about falling down the stairs, that's a dumb way to live your life.
Yeah, Greg.
I don't know why he keeps pointing you out, Greg. I'm not talking specifically to you or him either. I'm just saying.
I know, but I just like saying that, though.
Okay. That's fine.
Yeah, Greg. I like saying it, too. It's kind of fun. Yeah, Greg. Greg.
Welcome to another episode. It's doing long pauses. Of the Law Offices of Quibble, Squabble, and Bicker. On this November 2nd, 2022. What's wrong there, Greg?
Paul Harvey today? This is Paul Harvey.
That's the rest of the story?
Yes.
That's Paul Harvey? Yeah. And that's...
All right, we've made it to November. It's November 2nd. We've survived Halloween. No more Life is Horror clients.
Please, God.
Let's bring it back. Let's do that.
Yeah. We'll show people what true horror is. The same client a month in a row. All right, our client for today is your daddy has daddy issues. That is our client. But before we move on. What? It's all about Greg.
Behold, trapped in a hellscape of their own invention, socially unaware old white men bound by the pretense of being fake lawyers yet knowing no law, no exquisite Latin terminology, they are inexplicably compelled to quibble over minutiae, squabble over triflings, and bicker like those who value their backyards far too highly without even knowing the difference between an easement and an alleyway. At this very moment, you have entered the heart of the Law Offices of Quibble, Squabble, and Bicker. Let's get started.
Hello, my name is Barry White, and I am announcing my candidacy for president of this great sexy nation, which, if I am elected, will be renamed the Scintillating States of America. And just as my lips would never refrain from exploring every inch of a supple body, I won't stop. Oh, my face was out. Shit. Sorry, I'm not very right.
Well, you got to start over again. You've ruined the whole ambiance. You've taken us all out of the sponsor. Totally into it, and then you've just
starting to pull down my pants.
Let's just go.
Shut up. Go.
And start from the beginning.
And just as my lips would never refrain from exploring every inch of a supple body, I won't stop until the map of this country is a cornucopia of sensual delights. Nude Hampshire. Sexus, Californicadia, Oklahoma, Ohio, Lost Virginia, Tennessee, on the Florida, Wisconsin-lingus, Alabamya, Massachusetts.
Are you doing all 50 states?
No, I couldn't. There's some of them you couldn't make puns of. It didn't work.
Because sponsor should be like 30 seconds to a minute, Greg. It's not an hour.
It's only because I fucked up.
Don't make this an infomercial.
It would be almost 30 seconds if I wasn't like.
What's the proposed name for Oregon? I can't wait.
Oh, you're getting there. Okay. Hold on. Diana.
We're not even close, apparently.
Okay, here we go.
Yeah.
In Diana, nude Sexico. Organism. Shit. I don't know that word. Organism. Kentucky. And all the way down to Guam. We won't have to change that. That is already a sexy, sexy island. I'm on bended knee, wanting and pleading with you to vote for me. Barry White. Let's make America sexy again.
Paid for by the Americans for a Sexy Nation.
I have to say, Greg, that if you hadn't screwed that up, that would have been your best sponsor ever.
I could just redo the whole thing and like later on, and you could edit it in if you want. Like when we're done, we could record it.
Uh-huh. That's you're trying to give me even more work that I've already created for myself.
Okay, then let's not. It's fine.
But anyway,
good,
yeah.
Good job. I'm going to join. Is there a movement? Can I get
a phone number? A way to reach them?
Yeah. Well, yeah, it's the .gov. But what is it?
Sexyamerica.gov?
SensualUSA.gov.
But you have to type it with the accent.
How many U's and L's are in that domain? Greg, was that little or little sex? I don't know.
Okay. You're definitely trying to get yourself canceled with that one, Greg.
Why?
Well, because you know you're doing an accent of someone who's a different ethnicity than you.
Barry White.
Right, still someone of a different ethnicity than you. Remember how you said that accents are something they can get canceled for?
I know, but that's not really... I'm just making fun of a deep-voiced man. I'm not saying he's black.
Wait a minute.
You just did, though. You just said it, Greg.
I'm doing a deep-voiced man.
Okay.
Is Barry White still alive?
I don't know.
No idea.
Look it up.
I think he passed.
You think he would have a problem with this?
I'm just saying, you know, the Barry White people are probably some litigious people. I don't know. Just because litigious sounds fun.
Yeah, he died young, actually. He passed away in 2003. He was 58.
Litigious is a sexy word, too.
It is a sexy word. Too soon for Barry White at 58.
Yeah, no kidding. I mean, I see ages like that, I start getting nervous, you know?
Oh, yeah. Every time somebody's like, they'll have the headline and it's like, dead at 55. I'm like, oh, shit.
I know, and it's been happening a lot recently too.
Yeah, tell me he was murdered. That's all. If you're going to tell me somebody under 80 died, he better have been murdered, because I don't want to hear about it otherwise.
Under 80.
You know what makes me happy is when you hear about like Jim Fix. Remember the guy who wrote the big jogging book, started the jogging sensation in the 70s?
Yes.
This guy jogged every day, was fucking fit as a fiddle, and he died in like in his 50s. So those stories might be happy. It's like, it doesn't matter what I do.
Yeah, it's a congenital thing, you know, for him.
Yeah, I could have been working out my whole life and been healthy as a clam and eating wheat germ instead of pizza. I still might have died.
You could still eat wheat germ, Greg. There's nothing stopping you.
I don't want to.
Well, that's the big stop right there.
I feel a little guilty about it. Like, I should be healthier. And, you know, and it's like, why? I could get hit by a bus or die like Jim Fixed it.
It's got to deal with quality of life, Greg. That's why a lot of people do
this. That's
those
true. And this is why I think we should all just resort to taking heroin. Because who really cares?
I'm going to.
Because we're all going to die sometime.
When that's I'm why. Almost dead, when I'm 80, if I make it to 80, I'm taking heroin every day.
And I'm supporting that.
I die.
You're going to take heroin every day and when you crack. Make if you make it to 80 and crack at and 80 years old.
Who cares?
Why start at 80, Greg? Why not earlier?
Because it's a dilapidating addiction that will fuck up your life. But when I'm 80, I'm going to die any day now. So why not have fun?
Well, you don't know. You could make it another 20 years.
Do I want to?
Not if you're on heroin.
I don't want to. No.
Wait until you're 80? Why not do it at 70?
Well, yeah, maybe 70. Yeah, I don't want to live.
Well, then why not 60 then, Greg?
I'm volunteering to come and administer the injections. I'm just saying, Greg, I'm here for you. I will get on the max and get on the bus, and I'll be right on over to just...
Brendan's coming to give you your daily heroin and smoke your crack pipe with you.
He'll be man. I'm waiting for my man.
That's right. He's at the Pioneer Chicken Stand.
The Pioneer Chicken Stand, what?
Is that where you get the best heroin in town?
That is from the song Carmelita from Warren Zevon, where he meets his man at the Pioneer Chicken Stand. So,
All right.
Carmelita is one of the most beautiful songs about junkies I've ever heard. So,
Carmelita, check it out.
Yes, by Warren Zevon. For those of you out there,
I work with this 22-year-old trans woman, and the other day she was rhapsodizing about how much she loves Warren Zevon, and I was just like,
Now, the question I have, Greg, is that why do you have to specify the person is trans to us because we can't see her?
Because I'm prejudiced and a bigot. my Jewish friend, my half-Jew friend.
Does it add, I mean, it, does it add to the story? Did she then do something very
transy
about
transitionness?
Or were not you, really my, were my you Irish friend.
Because suddenly you felt like a little bit of love and then you didn't know what to do with that emotion?
Well, I guess basically is maybe it would like color the story in the fact that like she's a Portland total, you know, like woke trans, you know, but she still loves old fogey Warren Zevon. And the Warren Zevon is continuing to live on with the new generation.
Well, it's because of Werewolves of London for the most part.
That no, she was not that kind of fan. She's like, she was naming off all the like obscure songs. And...
Really?
Yeah, she didn't know Roland though, the Headless Thompson gunner.
Well, that's very sad.
I know, but she seemed to really get Warren Zevon and love him. And I thought you would be happy.
It's good to hear. You should, if she does karaoke, send her my way because I've got obscure Zevon songs for karaoke purposes. So anyway, well, let's get into our client. This has all been very exciting and new, discussing whatever we were just talking about. But we have a client, and our client is, your daddy has daddy issues. So, Greg, what does that mean to you?
I think my only daddy issue is that I was one of the few people I know who had a really great father who has no issues. So I really miss him that he's dead.
Yeah, but it's your daddy has daddy issues. So what is your daddy's daddy?
Your daddy has mommy issues.
My daddy had mommy issues. My mom was a very this is what I've sussed out from the stories. She was a very cold woman. And my dad for all
your grandmother?
Yes, my dad's mother. Uh-huh. And my dad always did have a problem showing affection. He was a great dad, the sweetest man you've ever met. But he also wasn't that affectionate. I mean, he wasn't a dick. It's like, it's still like, give me time, talk to me. But
he didn't show love.
It was hard for him. It was always a little,
I think that's a generational thing, really.
Could be, yeah.
I know. I mean, because my dad was not... I mean, my dad didn't hug me until I was in college that I can recall. And I was like disturbed by it, honestly. I was like, I was like, what's going on here? Why is he doing this? I'm like, should I hug him back? How does this work?
When he finally hugged you, you were like, oh my God, he must be dying.
I didn't know what was going on. It was very strange for me. See, what had happened was I had been away from the family for, I guess, about 2 years, because I had left. I went to high school overseas, went to college here in the States. Then eventually my parents arrived back in the States. They meet me at school, and my dad actually comes up and he like hugs me. And I'm like, do I hug back? How does this work? Is this, you know, it was weird for him to show that kind of affection towards me, because normally I always thought I was just like somebody who lived in the house to him. As opposed to somebody that he like cared about deeply or anything, you know, so that's why it was kind of odd for me. So, but Greg, you said that your dad didn't show you love, but you said he treated you well.
Oh yeah. He was like just the sweetest man in the world, but you could tell, like, it's not like he was always like hugging me like, oh, I love you, Greg. I mean, he did, he showed it in the way he acted to me that he loved He's a great man. And everyone I know has problems with their father. I've never met anyone who's like, yeah, my father, A-okay, great. What a great guy. There's always something like, he's kind of
I mean, the real question is, does any kid not have some shit about their parents? You know what I mean? No matter how loving their parents were or not loving or
what. Oh, definitely.
If it's one or the other, it's just kids grow up and they go, and sometimes they're led to believe this, all my problems are because of my parents, you know, that's why mom and dad were, so that's how it affected me. And I looked it up on YouTube, and I have, you know, post-traumatic stress syndrome because my dad was never hugged me enough and, you know, that kind of bullshit. But
Brandon, I have a problem. Like, your camera is bouncing up and down. What is going on there?
Oh, it's because I hit the desk.
It's been doing that for a while. I'm like starting to like feel like I'm on a ride.
That's a big one. What's finally happening.
There's an earthquake in North Portland.
Portland, but nowhere else. Just there.
Well, they got the first tremor. Maybe it's coming here.
Yeah, it's coming your way. It's past now, see?
Tremor is just one of those big worm things that comes up from underneath. That's what's coming for Brendan.
Oh, here it is.
Your next, Matt, it's coming your way. There it goes.
Is it really? I don't know about that.
Oh, shit.
What's happening now?
Stand in a doorway.
Run for cover.
Become a doorway. That would be the safer thing. Immediately turn into a door. Anyway, so we've got a little bit of Greg's daddy issues. He thinks his father was sweet, but that probably was just some hallucination of Greg's.
No, he was. Everyone loved my dad. Like, his funeral, all of his ex-patients, he was a dentist. There was, like, hundreds of people who were just like, I just came because your dad was such a great guy. He fixed my teeth when I was a kid. I mean, they were just, he was a really great guy.
That's right. Because
he fixed their teeth. That was his job. He was a dentist.
No, but would you go to your dentist's funeral? I wouldn't.
I did go to my dentist's funeral.
His name was Ray Bim, and he died a few years back, not too long, too soon.
Well, so my grandfather was my dentist, so yes, I went to his funeral.
I wasn't related to the guy. I actually went to his funeral because I thought he was a nice guy.
Yeah, it's rare for me to go to funerals, but I generally find out about people's deaths when I'm like across the country from them, so it's very rare.
Yeah, it's funny. Funerals. The last funeral I went to, that was where I got COVID. So I'm never going back.
No more funerals for Brendan. It's where COVID sits and waits for people.
That's right.
It's at funerals. So Greg, what do you think your dad's daddy issues were?
I don't think he was that. He was just an immigrant, not first generation. He came over on the boat.
Yeah.
And just worked his ass up all the time. And so I don't know, but he was a cultured, smart man. And my dad grew up listening to opera and shit. He loved opera, my dad, because of his father. And
your dad did what?
He loved opera and like he was a little kid listening, knew all the operas when he was 13. Like, his dad was an artist, but he came to America. I had one of his paintings, my grandfather. He was a great artist. It's just two dogs. It's not Picasso or anything, but he was a good artist, and he loved art, music, he wasn't just some dumb guinea off the boat, as they say. I could say that. I'm Italian. YouTube, don't cancel us.
It's not good for forwarding that type of thing though, Greg.
so he's my grandfather. I didn't know him. I didn't know my grandmother
either. But you said that your both of my grandparents, was that she was kind of a cold fish.
That's what I heard. The mother was more of, like, he didn't get the motherly nurturing that, my mom was very nurturing. She was crazy. She was a kind of a narcissist weirdo, but she also had the luxury to be very loving to us.
Your mother was a narcissist weirdo.
My mom always got away.
Everybody a narcissist these days?
Yes, no, like, but she really was. Like, my mom.
this time it's true.
my mom, I always say this. She got her way 99% of her life, everything. Like, and she had many techniques to do it. My dad quietly disagreed with her about something, like, oh, honey. She would, like, either yell or she'd get sulky.
Hold on, time out, Greg. You know what that's called? That's called a wife. All of them are that way.
My mom was really good at being a wife, though. She was.
Some are better than others.
Hammer down on my dad. My dad, I probably told you guys this. I was afraid of getting married my whole life. I thought, no, I'm never getting married, because I identified with my father. I literally thought being married means you never get to do what you want to do ever again for the rest of your life. That's what I thought marriage was. Anything. I know wives. I know, but my dad didn't.
Matt, are you okay? What's happening over there?
Yeah. Right? Is that like an offer?
Someone has just come into the house and the dogs just started barking. Now that we have two dogs. So I basically was muting myself and glaring into the other room.
All I know is, like, suddenly we had Matt Baracci as Alfred Hitchcock. And you were just this way of saying nothing.
Yeah, I saw the person walking up, and I'm like, this is about to happen. And so then the dogs start barking, and I'm like, all right, I've got to wait this out.
Matt, will you edit in the Alfred Hitchcock theme during that scene when you do
if you find it for me and send me the file?
It's on YouTube.
You should be able to find it easy then, Greg.
Yeah. But I don't know, it'll take you just as long.
Well, no, it'd be easier if you found it and you emailed it to me.
Fine, it was just a suggestion.
I always the suggestion, but you're not willing to do the work, but you're willing to give me the work to do.
But sometimes you go the extra yard, like you add all these images to my sponsors. Nobody asked you to do that, and it's
right. But in this case, you know, this was not a request of yours. This was a demand.
It was a request.
It was you were demanding it. You were pounding your
fist. I said you should.
You were pounding your fist on the table.
And I said, or else. Put in the theme, or else. There's going to be trouble.
Or else, I'll show you my daddy issues.
I'll walk. I'll fucking walk from this show.
No, I think daddy issues stem. I think that all issues that people currently have with their parents goes back to the days of cavemen. I think we're actually all acting like cavemen still. It's like there's physical traits, not physical traits, there's behavioral traits, characteristics that stem from the days of the caves still.
Definitely. Yeah, you know? For sure.
And I think it's, if we could figure out what those are, I think it would make for something very fascinating. That's my theory.
Okay.
Well, like with all our
trying to draw the connection between daddy issues,
yeah,
pavement. But hear me out. Isn't it mostly when we refer to these daddy issues? You know, this person has daddy issues. This person has mommy issues.
Yeah.
Doesn't it always seem, as or is it me, that girls are the ones with quote unquote daddy issues, and boys are the ones that have mommy issues?
It's the Electra complex and the
like. I don't know a lot of guys that have daddy issues.
Well, you know, it's just it all depends.
Stereotypically.
It's right. It's the definition. It's usually how it's presented, right? So, like with daddy issues, they tend to deal with women because that's how it's portrayed. But I think what has happened though is that people just they like to make things very binary that way. But I don't think it needs to be binary that way. I think the fact is that people got issues with either parent, and why separate them? You know,
I know a lot of dudes. But
I think it's true that one or the other of a parent, and I, as a parent, has more influence, generally speaking, on the kids than the other. Not necessarily with all of them, but maybe with this one or that one. You know, I knew parents growing up where the girls were very much their mother's daughters. You know, my girls were much more dad's tomboys. You know, because they hung out with me, and my girl played D&D, and she wears a beanie like this because she doesn't like to do her hair. So she was much more of a dad girl than a mom girl.
Yeah.
And there are, you know, so it goes that both ways. But I think that because my daughter, who would have more, you know, isn't being as feminine as maybe other girls, they go, oh, she's got daddy issues.
Well, I did come across an article where there are 8 signs that you have daddy issues. So I'll run through them really quick. I won't do the descriptions unless you want them. So 1, you have anxious attachments. 2, you're afraid of being vulnerable. 3, you use sex to feel loved. 4, you have trust issues. 5, you pick unhealthy partners. 6, you have trouble setting boundaries. 7, you put your partner on a pedestal. 8, you date people who are much older than you. I was going to say all of those relate to Greg, except for the last one.
I was going to say.
What are you talking about, Emily? Emily was 21 years younger than me.
And I know, but I'm talking about you having the daddy issues that you're not dating somebody who's much older than you.
Well, it's definitely with a guy. Like, it's like, I know guys who have daddy issues where their dad were like stern taskmasters. Either they rebelled and became hellions. They became little fucking rascals.
Rascals? Wait, how is a rascal on the same level as a hellion?
It's up there.
Well, were they rascals or were they actually hooligans? I mean, let's be frank.
Sometimes they would lapse into scofflaws.
Were they scalawags is the real question.
It's
only when they were young. Only when they were young scalawags. Were they scalawags.
Ne'er-do-wells? Some of them were just ne'er-do-wells.
Isn't that more older? I feel a little ne'er-do-well from time to time, but I've never felt like a scallywag.
Yeah, ne'er-do-well is a mild form of scallywagism. According to
Greg is currently becoming a schmendrick, though. So let's move this on.
I've always been a schmendrick. What do you mean currently? I'm the textbook definition of a schmendrick.
Textbook?
Yeah, look it up.
Here's a picture. What textbook has that word in it?
In the Yiddish dictionary has a picture of schmendrick, this guy.
In the Yiddish dictionary is a picture of an Italian person?
who looks very Jewish. That's why I get, everyone thinks I'm Jewish, so I pass.
That's because all of the anti-Semites out there think you're Jewish. That's really where it comes from. You know? Yes, if they're making those generalizations about somebody's appearance for their religion, then yes, they're anti-Semitic, especially if they think you're Jewish.
No.
Since you're not.
I know a lot of girls who fucking love Jewish guys. They're like, they're just crazy for them. And I've gotten some of that runoff. When I used to go to the sex club, this one girl came up to me and she just said, and you know, I didn't get much play there. She literally came up to me and she said, hi, and she started chatting with me. It's like, and one of the first questions, she was like, are you Jewish? And I knew she was like into it and I could have lied. I was like, nah, I'm actually not. But she's like, oh my God, you look so Jewish. And
you said you kind of lied.
No, I thought of lying, but I didn't.
Oh, got it. Okay.
You wanted to lie.
Yeah, I wanted to because I was like, whoa, this girl's just like.
Did you tell her Jewish? You play a Jew on TV?
Well, I told her how a lot of people mistake me for a Jew, and then we went up to a room and fucked.
Okay. Well, that was a nice romantic story.
It's not romantic, but
maybe she has daddy issues. And
she was way younger.
Her daddy, wait, let me up. Her daddy was a racist, maybe a Nazi. And so she needed to make sure that you were Jewish. She actually gave the right answer. Had you said yes, she would have turned around, threw a drink in your face, and walked away or something like that.
It's entirely possible.
That's a part of the daddy issue is like, you know, like, I'm going to pick a guy that'll piss off my dad. Like, my dad's a racist, I'm gonna fuck a black guy. You know, that's a thing.
Yeah.
I dated a girl in high school on that vibe. I went with it. She brought me home because I was a punk rocker and they were a very well-to-do Mormon family. And I knew what I was getting into and I went just hammered down into it. Went there for Thanksgiving dinner with my mohawk.
You were a piece of strange.
That's because he looked like a turkey. That's why she brought him.
Yeah, that's right.
It's the mohawk. He went up there and he just gobbled his way through it.
Yeah.
Are you talking about cunnilingus, Matt?
No, I'm talking about the sound a turkey makes, you twit.
Gobble, gobble, gobble.
But what was funny was she dumped me about 2 weeks later because during the course of the evening, I really got to like her dad, and her dad had me come in. Me and the dad.
Oh, of course. That's so typical. Watching
football, and I'm like, hey, come on. And she's like, he's like, you know, he's not such a bad guy. He's an artist, whatever. And I'm like, yeah. 2 weeks later, gone. I'm like, oh, okay.
Yes, so typical. She was like, he's going to piss off my dad so much. And it's like, oh, wait, he likes
him. No, so. I don't know what her problem was. Her dad was super cool, actually.
Yeah.
And so you didn't know what her problem was?
Well, does she have daddy issues? I mean, isn't that the client? I don't know.
Yeah, what I think she was trying to piss off her dad.
But right. What about her father? What were her father's daddy issues?
That he was a Mormon? I don't know. I have no idea. I didn't get that close to the guy.
Yeah.
You should have just kept coming back to the house after she broke up with you.
Nah, I mean, I should have. That would have been great. It's like she comes home with her new boyfriend. I'm like, what's up? Hey, Steve. I'm hanging out with you.
She's gonna break up with you soon too if you don't piss off her dad.
You gotta make this guy mad if you want to get her in bed, dude.
How did her father feel about his great-great-grandfather? Did you ever get around to that?
We never talked about it. I kind of stayed off the whole subject of religion, and so did he for reasons that would seem obvious.
It is kind of interesting that great-grandfathers tend to be totally forgotten at a certain point. In other words, they were like very prominent in somebody's life, and then for the most part, for I think nearly 90% of humanity, they're forgotten and never talked about again. And that like their time,
nobody knows them.
Their time on this planet was irrelevant at that stage. But that's a different client.
I was going to say, that's a lot to unpack, Matt. I mean, we're talking about the transcendental nature of time and the impact one has on the memories.
And mortality.
That go beyond a generation, you know.
Apparently, those are my issues.
If your great-grandfather was Teddy Roosevelt, it would matter. It would be like, oh.
Well, you know, I was just looking up I was watching the show. It was Brave New World on Peacock, who is one season based upon the book, right? And I was looking up one of the actors on it, and it turns out that actor's great-great-great-grandfather was Charles Dickens.
Oh.
And I'm like, oh, so there you go. Somebody, you know, somebody famous you're related to down the road.
That's and, a sexy name, Charles Dickens. Dickens. This is a very sexy name.
All right.
Right. Is it Greg?
Carry on, Matt. I was listening.
I was listening to you, man.
Anyway, I don't know. I guess the only point I'm making about it is just that you can have people who are really well known or not well known, but it doesn't really affect your current life, I suppose, unless you make it some kind of great grandfather daddy issue. You know, in other words, it's like, I had a friend who had problems because he couldn't go to war, but his dad had gone to war, and his dad had gone to war, and his dad had gone to war, and so he was supposed to go to war too, you know, but he didn't. He grew up in the wrong time, so he thought there was like something wrong with him because he didn't have to go to war. And you know, the fact, I mean, if you like base your current personality on what your father or his father did, it seems like that's something that could affect you in a weird psychic way. This guy
sounds
way.
Like an idiot though.
Yeah, but yeah, no, yeah, pretty obviously stupid. If there's I was gonna say there's institutional sort of things. There's like people, like if you're the son of a Rockefeller, well then that has an inordinate impact on you because of the money and the fame and all that.
Right.
But beyond that, you get into traditions where it's like, I'm a coal miner, my dad was a coal miner, or a soldier, or army, or a priesthood, or whatever it may be, and then it becomes more of a role that you fit into society, and your parents kind of box you into that.
It's like if you're a junior or a third or a fourth.
I've never understood that. I knew a guy, I worked with a guy who was Frederick the Third. And I'm like, who kept that going?
Well, I believe that was the Barbarossas kept that going, wasn't it?
I don't know.
In Germany.
Frederick the Third. Barbarossas?
Oh, I don't know what I was going to say.
Frederick is a shitty name, too. Why would you want to keep Fred going? Like, it's not that great.
Yeah, it's not a good
name. Nobody likes Fred.
Yeah, Frederick. Fred is no different than Greg.
No, Greg's a terrible name too. I grant it.
But I was never. I'm just saying names are names. It's like, well, no, they had meaning at one point.
But here's the thing about this guy: if you called him Fred, he'd lose his mind. With Freddie, he needed to be called Frederick, and you had to spell it correctly.
Oh, was it with a K or with a C?
It was Fred with a K.
C-K.
With a K.
C-K, yes, traditional, but. But so I would, if he would piss me off, I would call him Freddie or Fred. Just
I know a guy named William who would only go by William. You could not call him Bill.
What the fuck is wrong with those people?
He's like,
Do you guys remember we did the podcast about names or destiny? Your names are your destiny. And that came up where it's like, yeah, it's not like your name is your destiny, but if you're the kind of guy who insists that like, oh, my name is Gregory, don't call me Greg. That you know what that person's like. They're kind of anal retentive old bitch. If somebody's like, I'm Frederick. Don't call me Fred. Who gives a shit? You can call me Gregory if you want. Greggy. I'm not going to think about it.
I used to have issues with people calling me Matthew. I didn't want to be called Matthew. I just wanted to be called Matt.
I totally get it. Because it just seems so formal. And you're like, nah. The weird part of my name is, what are you going to call me?
Yeah,
Brendan, Brenny, B became B. Yeah, B.
Okay.
That's how it ended up.
It could be Dan. If you really hated your name, you'd be like, no, I'm Dan.
No,
well, what's your middle name, Brendan?
That Dan, getting to daddy issues, Daniel was my dad's name, so I definitely wouldn't want to be a Dan. My middle name is Ian, which is why I named my first son Ian. Well, that
just is an odd, weird coincidence. So my brother's name is Ian, and his middle name is Frederick.
Ooh. wait, it's past Halloween. We can't have some sort of Twilight Zone episode now.
Ian's a cool name. I would have an Ian the Second if I spawned a child. I'd be like, yeah,
that's Ian the Second. You could change your name to Ian, Greg, if you want to.
Yeah. I guess I could.
Yeah. You don't look very Ian, though. I'm just going to tell you.
You know what else is extra douchey, speaking of people who care about their names, is people who change their names late in life. That's just like, wow, that's so sad. Like, you obviously have a problem with yourself, and you're just, you know, like, oh,
what if my name was Fred, and I changed it to Dana.
Dana?
Yeah.
Like Dana Gould?
No, I'm just saying he's saying...
Dana Carvey?
No, he's saying people that change their names obviously have some sort of problem, because why didn't they just accept themselves as they were? And I'm saying, what if somebody had a masculine name and changed it to a feminine name?
Oh, if they want to like transition, yeah.
Oh, you said Dana though. So Dana's not necessarily a feminine name.
Yeah, that's,
okay,
yeah.
Sorry.
Let's say Petunia. Petunia.
Yeah.
Wow. If somebody became Petunia and they were transitioning, of course.
But they had to be transitioning. So somehow there's some demarcation. Because if I want to be, if I want people to call me Sting, but my name is Brendan, then I'm an asshole.
What about Laser?
I want you to call me Linda, and my name is Brendan. As long as I've decided to wear a dress, then it's okay.
Why can't he be called Linda without having the transition?
You could.
But then I would just be changing my name. So where does that differentiate between just changing my name to Linda or changing my name?
It smacks of like, I feel sorry for this person that they hate themselves so much or have an issue that they have to change their name. Like,
what if their first name was Hitler?
That's a good point. Yeah, then you should change your name. Yeah.
My name is Cunnilingus. I really don't want this name.
My name's Shithead. My dad.
It's like those parents who name their children's numbers or whatever. You know, I think sometimes people have the right to change their name if they want to.
Yeah, if Musk's kid grows up and is like, this is bullshit, I want to be called Mike. Good for him.
I knew a guy who was German. I can't remember what his original name was, and he changed his name to Johnny when he moved here, like legally, because he didn't want to be known by the German name anymore.
I had a girl that worked for me whose name was Man Tam, and when she finally immigrated into the United States, she changed her name to Connie, which I used to tease her about. I'm like, do you know how stereotypically Asian it is to have the name Connie? Really? Anyway, but so she changed her name because
Is it stereotypical for Asians to be named Connie?
I knew a lot of Asian Connies. Did you?
No. But I didn't go around asking Asian women their names though either. So that could be part of it.
Oh, so you never met them?
I met a lot of Asians when I was living in Asia, and none of them were named Connie.
Well, that was the
come to America.
Yeah, I'm saying in America.
Right. I mean, the famous Connies. I know Connie Stevens, Connie Francis. Wasn't Genghis there a Connie? Newscaster named Connie? Connie Chung? Right. So she's the one Asian Connie I know. I think.
Genghis Khan. Well,
the others were all Genghis from like Connie. The 1930s or something. Connie Chung is like of our time and age. What did you say? Yeah.
The Wrath of Connie.
Genghis Khan. Genghis Khan. He was Asian.
I would change.
That's what he changed his name to.
His actual name was Frederick. And he was like, no one's scared of Frederick Khan. I'm going to be Genghis.
What about the whole movement where people are trying to repronounce it as Genghis Khan? Just supposedly how it's actually pronounced. Yeah.
Who cares?
Why did they wait this long to tell us this? I'm always amazed at that.
Well, it's like Neanderthal.
No, I know. And like Nietzsche. Like my whole childhood, it was Nietzsche. And then all of a sudden I get to college. It's like, no, it's Nietzsche. It's like,
the word niche these days, or niche, or however you want to pronounce it.
You could have told me that when I was growing up. Why you just decided?
He's actually Friedrich Nietzsche.
Nietzsche.
Just Nietzsche. Gosh, you know, we've moved way past the halfway point. It's time for, what's his name?
For
that
me
guy.
Pee.
Pretty to pee.
It's Greg's pee pee time.
I was waiting. I was like, shit, I gotta pee
time with Greg.
It's taken so long to get to the stage. What is going on? Why is that happening? We don't know.
You know, the great thing about it being fall is we never have to see Greg naked again.
Yeah,
that's true. He might still do it though on like a warm day.
Oh, it's never that warm. This week at Safe Mart, catheters. On sale.
I think it's only food they sell there.
Safe Mart, it's a Safe Mart. Come to Safe Mart and be safe.
Safe Mart is a proud sponsor of Food is for Eating with Waspy
that
Soda.
That is too many lemons.
Today's special, Hormigas Culonas, Big Butt Ants. Only $50 a handful. Come get some. Safe Mart. Be safe.
Food is for eating. Food is for eating. Food is for eating with Waspy Soda Pop.
Hello, I am a gap so the pop. I am a wasp so the pop brother. We were twins at birth. I am La Belgique. Today we are a recipe for pom-pom frites. It's very good. Do you get the 4 to 6 roasted potato, cut into sizes you prefer? 4 child size pom-poms, rendered beef fat for the frying, and the salt. Here is how you make it. You preheat some of the rendered beef fat in a deep fryer or a pot to 300 degrees Fahrenheit Celsius would be bad. Burn your house down. You add the prepared potato to a large container filled with the cold water. Submerge the cut potato in the water and let them stand for about 10 minutes. Next, move the potato around the water with your hand to get off some starch. Then strain them in a colander, rinse them well with cold water for 3 to 4 minutes. Let the potatoes drain off any excess water for an additional 2 to 4 minutes. Add a few handfuls of the cut potatoes to the hot fat and cook for 3 minutes. Move them around after 90 seconds. You may need to do this in batches. Remove the fries from the hot fat and keep them in the fryer basket or place them on a sheet tray lined with parchment paper. Turn the oil up to 350 degrees Fahrenheit, not Celsius again. You burn your house down. Grab the pom-poms while shaking them. Say, go frit, go! Go frit, go! Go frit, go! 3 times. Then quickly submerge the pom-poms in the fat. Add a few handfuls of the pre-fried potatoes to the hot fat and cook for 5 to 6 minutes or until crispy and browned on the edges. You can cook an additional 1 to 2 minutes to crisp up and brown more. Drain the potatoes in the basket for no longer than a minute and then transfer them to a bowl. Toss with salt. Serve immediately. Now you have the best pom-pom frites in the world. In the world. I am Gip Soda Pop from La Belgique. Belgium, you call it. Goodbye. I say goodbye. Goodbye.
Well, Matt, I like to be supportive, but that was the worst French accent I've ever heard in my life. But I was laughing the whole time.
Did you actually hear a French accent in there?
I could use an attempt. I guess you were trying.
It kind of came in and out of waves.
Yeah, it was like Spanish.
There were certain vowels that you'd hit right, and then it would just sort of devolve into this. Like,
I asked my wife earlier to count like how many different accents she heard in it. I'm like,
there's a lot.
It's kind of like 4 or 5 of them in there. I don't know that French ever made its way in there, but it's Belgian, so it can get away with it, I think. He was Soda Pop's Belgian twin brother who was separated at birth, apparently. So
is that the real Latin terminology really translates to big fat bottom ants?
Big butt ants. Are you talking about what Safe Mart was selling?
Yeah, is that what the Latin of that genus is?
I think that was Spanish, Greg, not Latin.
No, it was like you called them like by their real like scientific name, you know, like
big butt ants was the scientific
name. No, but then in parentheses, did you have like something, something, something? Like
I can't remember.
It's actually big butte, not big butt, but it just became butt.
That was straight out of what was it? Not Buzz Lightyear, Buckaroo Banzai. Buzz Lightyear in the Fifth Dimension. That's a whole different movie.
One of my children has, no matter where you go, there you are, tattooed on their body.
Their entire body.
Well, I mean, they have a tattoo.
Now, was it from Buckaroo Banzai? Because that was used in another movie I saw once, where they actually used that as the big line. And I was like, that's from Buckaroo Banzai. You can't use that.
No,
I can't remember what movie it was. But some major Hollywood movie, like 8 years after that, it was like, no matter where you go, there you are. It's like, you can steal a line from Buckaroo Banzai.
Yeah, it's probably in Die Hard or something. So anyway, we need to move on to our legal segment as well, though. So we can't leave Greg hanging, especially since Brendan has done so much work to find finding letters.
I love that. We'll be doing some karaoke.
Legal questions for Greg.
I prefer a song.
I have all your Oingo Boingo beat cuts.
He has an opinion, may not always be right. He's a real fake lawyer, he's old and he's white. Ask him a question, 'cause he's a good egg for bogus advice. Ask Greg. Ask Greg? Ask Greg!
Me. Ask Greg. Ask all right. Me. What letter, or what is the, what is it we got? What do we got for Greg?
Well, we have an email here. I'll just read it as written. All right.
That's a good idea.
It's not a letter or a postcard.
It's an email. Okay. Dear Greg, let me cut to the chase. I want to know if I can fucking sue Superman. Here's the deal. He literally destroyed my family's business, fighting some other dipshit about who the hell knows. They destroyed a city block, including my restaurant, and then took off. What do I do? Contact the government? Call Galactus? Can your firm represent me? Now, don't blow me off like you do the other idiots who write in. Sincerely, Max Von Doom. What is this? P.S. The guy who reads these on the show is a moron. That is why this is in all caps.
So I don't know if Max Von Doom is related to Victor Von Doom, otherwise known as Dr. Doom. So that's interesting because he's a supervillain. So
I know, and you're wearing his cape today, apparently.
Yeah, wow, that is very Dr. Doomy. Finally, I'm not gonna ask. But yeah, so a lot of this is extra legal advice. First of all, do not call Galactus because he will eat our planet. It's like, you know, bringing a blowtorch to a knife fight. It's not.
Greg, you're acting like comic books are real and superheroes are real. They're not. Are just weird. So you know, they're neither of those two things.
Comic books
in your world, maybe they're not real.
Galactus is not a real person, Greg. So they're not going to call them and have them come and eat our planet.
How do you know that?
The same way you know that God is real.
Oh, because science is so perfect that they just haven't found Galactus yet. He's out there. He could be. And he's going to want to eat our planet. So that's worse than having your store demolished by Superman. Also, it's Superman. It's kind of hard to, like, give him a summons. I mean, you might have to go to his Fortress of Solitude. He might not show up in court. But, you know, I've never done this before. Maybe you want to edit this out. I'm saying you might have to take this extra legally, Punisher style. This is the one time I'm going to say, fuck the law. Get you some kryptonite. Okay. That's the only thing that'll show this guy, you know, fuck you, Superman. That's the only thing. Get some kryptonite.
And
you know, like, pretend that there's some disaster, you know, make some disaster. Maybe make a volcano blow up in Oregon so Superman will come.
Volcano in Oregon?
And kill his ass, you know, like, because I know this is so not lawyerly of me. Lawyerly? It's, but
it seems like rather extreme advice for a store that got demolished, too, though, Greg.
No, but Superman's a menace. He's doing this all the time. He's like,
yeah, but starting, having a volcano go off, that seems a little extreme.
I'm not in Oregon. I mean, can we make the volcano go off in, like, West Virginia or something?
Do you know that we're waiting for the volcano here?
I know there's volcanoes all over. That's what I'm saying. Send it over there. Yeah.
Okay, so
Greg, you're taking this a little too realistically in terms of...
Well, because I'm a very realistic lawyer.
I mean, if we're going to go this route, then you should know that Superman has an alter ego named Clark Kent, and so that anybody who's friends with Clark Kent could be gone after for those purposes, as opposed to going to a volcano, you know.
Okay, what about this? Brendan shaves his head, pretends to be Lex Luthor, dresses up and, like, makes a fake laser gun and says, I'm taking over Portland. I'm going to be the mayor of Portland by force. Superman will come down. He'll be like, hey, it's my old enemy, Lex. And then you take a kryptonite, a suppository, some kind of kryptonite thing to invade his system. And because I know this is so
involved detail.
No,
it's really extra legal advice you're giving,
exactly,
Greg.
Exactly. I'm not being a lawyer.
I'm gonna have to download the YouTube video to transcribe this or something. I stopped making notes a minute ago. Anyway, go ahead.
Yeah, well, that's...
you became like an arch villain at a certain point there, Greg, in creating this all master plan of how to get back at Superman for this guy whose store, where he's just looking for legal recourse as opposed to further breaking the law.
There's no legal recourse with Superman. He's above the law.
But if he has this alter ego, which we all know is the alter ego.
Nobody knows this.
We all know it, Greg. But you're right. We're in the world answering the question right now, Greg.
I don't know if Max knows this or not.
Well, he knows it now.
I mean, now he does.
If he's watching. If he's watching now, he knows it now.
He says the guy who thinks he's on the show is a moron. He must be a fan.
You can give a subpoena to Clark Kent, and he would still just be like, fuck you, I'm Superman. I'll fly away. I'm not coming to show up in court.
Yeah, but the thing is, he has a job. I mean, does he have no purpose for that alter ego anymore now that we all know what it is?
He still likes to report things. He likes doing the crossword puzzles.
Really? He does. He does it in the movies of his and the cartoons of his that we've watched, the comic books of Superman, who doesn't exist as a real human being at all.
It's like a hobby for him.
Yeah.
I thought he was a reporter. You're saying he's in charge of the crossword puzzle? That's kind of cool.
Well, that's part of working for a newspaper, you know, reporting.
That's part of the job.
I never got to work on the crossword puzzle. That was just something we got from a subscription service, and they just plopped it in there, and I had to wax it down and put it in place.
Brendan has that earthquake going again.
Oh, that's right. I touched my desk.
Well, yeah, I used to watch this documentary called Kolchak The Night Stalker about a reporter in the 70s. He was a reporter for Chicago.
Oh, what tangent are we going to go off on now?
There was a woman there who would do the crossword.
Remember, folks, this started with a letter from a person with some legal questions.
Greg is bringing up Kolchak the Night Stalker to talk about crossword puzzles.
He was a reporter from the 70s. He was a real reporter.
Whose name is Max von Doom? I mean, are we really working with the right people here, Greg?
I'm trying to help Max in any way I can because he's got no legal recourse. Superman's not going to show up in court. He doesn't have, you know, he's got immunity. Intergalactic immunity, it's called.
No, is that what it's called?
That's okay. Why he's trying to reach out to Galactus, I think.
No, don't do
I just
that.
Don't know how you're like switching between Marvel and DC Comics here.
Galactus will be worse. Galactus will be like way worse than Superman destroying your store. He'll eat your planet.
So what the
kills, take care of Superman, take him out so he can't do this anymore.
So you're advocating death is what you're saying.
Yes, Superman's a menace.
Murder. You're advocating something totally against the law is what you're doing.
Superman, yes, it's the one time. That's why maybe we have to censor this episode and maybe cut it out. I had no other idea in my head legally what to do.
You could have actually taken him to court, Greg.
He would not show up. He's Superman.
You don't know this. You don't know he wouldn't show up.
What is the bailiff?
He's supposed to be a good guy, right?
Well, wait a minute.
Isn't he supposed to be a good guy?
Yeah, I mean, we have to really talk about Superman's basic nature. I mean, in terms of character alignment, I mean, I've always pictured Superman as more the lawful good guy. So if
he is.
If you told him he had to go to report to court, he would.
And yet he destroyed your house and just flew off.
I think we're getting to the nature of Greg's daddy issues right now.
My dad was a Superman. He was great.
He was a Superman?
And my dad, if he destroyed
your Greg's
house,
father was such a sweet person that Greg has turned to the dark side and is advocating the death of Superman through a kryptonite suppository.
Yes.
And I didn't even know Superman had hemorrhoids, so that he's buying
those.
He doesn't
need them. You just shove it up his ass.
No, really? How close would you get to Superman to be able to do that?
Pretty close. Very close.
Can you imagine the sphincter power that Superman has?
Oh, he could like inject it. He'd spit it out.
Yeah.
That's never talked about in the comic books.
No.
Sphincter power.
I would put something
new. Wait, wasn't that part of the power on the planet Dune as well? They had sky power, sea power, and sand power, and then there's also
sphincter power.
I bet Superman could hold his shit for like a year. He could have to take a wicked shit. He could just be like, no, not gonna shit.
Right, because he had super strength intestines that could hold it all in without exploding.
No, what he could do is he could actually just super pull the food back through the whole process and just pull out a burrito.
He can recreate the food that he had eaten.
Yes.
If he eats anything. We don't know that either. All right. Well, that was fun. Okay. Well, thank you, Greg, for that useful legal advice for a comic book person. in who apparently watches this podcast and needed to know about killing Superman in some way. All right. Well, we can discuss our client a little bit further, or we can just give Brendan the last word. Which do we choose?
That late? Oh, it's six.
We're already we've hit the hour mark already.
We have hit the hour mark.
All right. I think it's time, though. I think it's time we just...
You guys never talked about your daddy issues. It's just me.
I did a tiny little bit.
Know what? That'll be the last word.
Okay.
That none of us have daddy issues or something?
I don't know. We'll find out when I...
Yeah.
When my stupid Swedish chef intro gets done playing.
Anyone else is totally... I will accept anybody else's entries to new theme songs for any of us, actually. So
I know.
Just do it in English. That's all we're asking. As long as it's in English.
This is the last word. That's English. Brendan Haggerty.
Yep.
And Nero. Brutality. Sin.
Tonight we talked a lot about a lot of things, but we were supposed to be talking about our client daddy issues. And we heard a lot about Greg's dad, who sounds like a fantastic guy, and Matt's dad, who, I don't know, we didn't really hear as much about Matt's dad. We heard a lot about Greg's dad. So let me tell you about my dad. But more importantly, let me tell you about me as a dad. So my dad was an awful person, but I didn't know him. So he didn't really have an impact on me. I could say he did, that his impact was oversized compared to the amount of time I spent in my life because I had to deal with brothers and sisters who would tell me, or brothers, that would tell me what an awful person he was. So my dad was sort of a myth and a legend more than he was an actual impact in my life, other than when I did see him, I was just scared of him. But I think most boys at 4 or 5 are scared of their dads because, you know, whatever. The real key is that being a dad is a tough job. And if you give your children issues relative to wherever or however you acted, it's probably their fault and they just need to grow up and get over it. And that's the last word. You got daddy issues? Don't care. Move on. Put on your
big boy. I like how you gave yourself a blanket exemption here. Like, you don't have to feel any guilt if your kids end up bad. Like, that's their fault. I did great as a dad.
Well, you know, here's the thing as a parent, because I can speak to this that you can't, because I've actually made people.
Made them with his own bare hands.
Well, it wasn't my bare hands, but
his bare sperm.
His bare ass, at least.
Be that as it may, sphincter power. The thing is, yes, you have an impact on your kids, but you or your kids, whoever, anybody for that matter, needs to just have an over impact on themselves and not let things that they have no control over affect their lives in negative ways.
Yeah, Greg.
They should pull themselves up by their bootstraps.
Yeah, basically that's what I'm saying.
Even if the father aimlessly raped them every day.
It's their
fault. Yeah. They should get over it.
Yeah, they should.
Get over your damn anal raping issues.
What? Can you tell me what the alternative is?
Trauma. Well,
it's not like you have a choice. It's like the human brain.
If you don't have a choice, then you just have to deal with it.
What does getting over it actually entail anyway? So how does one get over things?
Probably denial. Pretending it didn't happen. Just like, no, it was a nightmare. No,
you know what you do? You just move on with your life. And that's a healthy attitude.
And you never think about things of the past. That's what it is he's talking about. So you never think about things that have happened in your past.
Memories deep
I love
down
how the last word has really just turned into a debate. So no, I'm not saying that you...
No, we're just trying to understand, I think.
Well, what I'm saying is you don't have to have what happened in the past have an outsized impact on your experience of life today. If I fell down the stairs tomorrow... On Friday, if I sat in my room and just felt bad about falling down the stairs, that's a dumb way to live your life.
Yeah, Greg.
I don't know why he keeps pointing you out, Greg. I'm not talking specifically to you or him either. I'm just saying.
I know, but I just like saying that, though.
Okay, that's fine.
Yeah, Greg. I like saying it, too. It's kind of fun. Yeah, Greg.
Greg.
Gregory.
You got a good name for that. Mine never worked.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mine always sounds like something outside your front door.
Yeah, when my mom was mad at me, because my mom was who raised me, my mom, she would say my first and middle name. That's when I knew I was in trouble. It was Brendan Ian.
And became fully Irish.
Exactly. I came out with a shillelagh and started river dancing around.
My mother never did that, but my wife does that.
What?
Really?
Does both names.
If she's mad at you?
Yes, exactly.
Find out if she's Irish?
No, I'm not. I don't have an Irish first or last name or middle
name.
No.
Is
yeah, she says your names to me. That's right. She calls me Brendan Ian when she's mad at me.
No, that's not what I'm saying. Whatever.
Gregory David. That's how I always hear it too with the New York accent. It's like Gregory David. Because my mom's friends would do that too when they were mad at me. If I was over at their house and I was misbehaving, Gregory David.
Yeah, I don't know what that is. I think that for the longest time, I thought that's why people had middle names.
So they know if they were in trouble?
Yeah. Yeah, because middle names are basically stupid when you think about it, right?
Sometimes it's good to have that middle name if you don't like your first name.
Okay.
You go by that. For example, I'll give two examples. One is my dad, who doesn't like his first name. So he goes by Wayne, but his first name is Gilbert.
Oh, I can kind of understand that.
And my uncle, who's my mother's brother, goes by James or Jimmy, but his first name is Carol.
Oh, that's 100%
understand that one.
Yeah.
Well, I don't know. Carol O'Connor made it work.
Yeah.
But it probably took him all of it. That's probably why he was able to play a racist so good. Because, trauma of that first name.
That's why he excelled as an actor. He was fighting against that his whole life. He's like, I'll show that.
And if he had taken Brendan's advice of just getting over it, he might never have been as good of an actor.
I don't know. Those two things don't have anything to do with one another.
No, he wouldn't have had a chip on his shoulder.
I love how you artificially conflated them into the same thing, but it doesn't work that way.
Artificially conflating is actually my stage name.
that's your rap name, Lil Flator.
Lil Flator.
Lil Flator. Lil Flator. No, it's not. You got to take out the just Lil Flator.
Flator.
Okay, well,
hater, I'm Little Flata.
Yeah. Well, this has been another episode of the Law Offices of Quibble, Squabble, and Bicker. We're coming into Thanksgiving season in a few weeks.
Brendan's debut, if you're in the Portland area, on Tuesday night, starting at roughly 8:30 to 9, Suki's open mic night, Brendan will be unleashing his comedy onslaught.
Unleashing.
Show up.
If you don't get enough of him here in the podcast.
Yeah, if you're a listener to the show and you live in Portland,
you can actually see what his legs look like if you go there.
I'll wear shorts.
Right.
Even though it's 42 outside.
Suki's Bar and Grills. Suki.
Is there any other details you'd like to give, Greg?
Their phone number.
It's a sports bar. They have very good
there are
food.
People who work there, and these are where they live, too.
Yes.
They have like one IPA because they seem to run out, but they have another varieties of beers and cocktails. And I think
they do chill their Jaeger. They have a Jaeger chilling tap, a special Jaeger tap just that keeps it cold, which I admire.
This tells you the kind of people that go there. They have
Korean barbecue for their food there as well. So
I didn't know that.
I don't know if it's barbecue, but it's Korean food. Anyway, all right. So our client was your daddy has daddy issues. That was our client, and this is the Law Offices of Quibble, Squabble, and Bicker. And we'll be back next week with who knows what. Might be a guest, might not be a guest. I don't know.
Our consultation with the Law Offices of Quibble, Squabble, and Bicker has ended. You may pay your retainer at www.qsblah.org. Please exit to the right of the water cooler and grab a candy from the front desk. We hope to see you again soon, but you need to leave now. I said leave. Why don't they ever listen? Get out! Get out!